Hey, what's up guys? It's Nick. Welcome to another episode of T-Minus 365. Today's episode, we're covering the updates from August of 2023 from Microsoft. And if you follow along with my update videos in the past, you know I focus in on what's relevant to the MSP space, blocking out the noise from the 100 or so announcements that come from Microsoft each month. As always, if this content's helpful, go ahead, like, and subscribe to the channel. But otherwise, let's go ahead and dive in. We're going to start off with Microsoft Teams as we usually do. Just a quick disclaimer though, I do supplement these videos with a blog post with more information about each announcement, helpful links, how-to articles, things like that. So be sure to check that out after we get through here. First announcements related to group policy assignment rank assistance. And basically within the Teams admin center here, as you can see in this screenshot, you're getting some assistance around the partitioning of your policies. If you have many groups assigned to different policies, they allow you to get some recommendations around the rank, and the rank basically dictates what takes precedence if a user has policy conflicts here. So this will happen mid-August to be complete by late August. Next one here is specifically for Teams premium users or premium licensing. This is the proactive monitoring of meeting quality using real-time telemetry. So this is again getting proactive around issues as it relates to audio, video, the content sharing, network connectivity issues, those types of things. So instead of your users submitting support cases to you after a while of frustration, you can get ahead of it and try to remediate those issues on their behalf depending on what that issue is. The other cool feature here that you can see in the screenshot is it does send these adaptive cards in Teams about whenever the degradation, if you will, is discovered with information about it that you can then go investigate. This will happen mid-October and be complete by mid-November. Next one here is a really cool feature, I think, as well, too. This was announced at Inspire, but it has been updated with some timelines here. But this is giving users the ability when they click a link in Teams to open up a browser like Edge here. And you can see in the screenshot, it has a side-by-side view where your Teams environment is still open and accessible, and you're able to access the web browser view for whatever you clicked on as far as that link goes. So you don't have to switch and have the switching context problem. This will be happening in late September. Next one here is, I think, is a great sales opportunity or push for MSPs. This is a Teams premium trial that will be available to all users to be able to initiate a self-service trial and be available for 60 days. So as an MSP, it could be a good time to have an upsell cross-sell opportunity and pitch some of the more attractive Teams premium features like the AI summaries of meetings and notes and things like that. Even the feature that I just alluded to with the proactive monitoring could be something that you pitch to the business leaders to help alleviate any Teams concerns, because we all had those in the past. The other one here is the shared line experience. And so within the Teams voice experience, you can have shared lines for your delegates, things like that, if you're managing multiple lines on behalf of other users, such as EA, for instance. And within the mobile experience, as you can see in the screenshots, you're getting this UX UI to be able to see the shared lines and configure them, as well as view them on the right-hand screenshot as well. This will happen late August and be complete by early September. The last one here for Microsoft Teams is this near real-time calendar sync and updates. It's a nice-to-have feature. I've noticed this in the past, but it's simply saying that whenever you schedule a meeting in Outlook, for instance, on your desktop, you move to mobile, it might not show right away. So this is supposed to solve for that with near-time real updates, where you can actually see once you schedule a meeting in Outlook on your device or even on Teams on your device, it replicates into the Teams mobile experience. This will happen late August to be complete by September. Shifting into Entra ID here, I did mention last month, this is a name change. This used to be Azure AD, just a name change, nothing functionally different about this. First announcement here though is conditional access for protected actions is GA. And this is a cool feature to me because it does allow you some more granular protections against certain actions like modifying conditional access policies. So you can require additional controls, just like regular conditional access policies, to say maybe that user has to be on a compliant device, they have to use FIDO2 authentication to be able to make those changes. So it's a pretty cool feature. I link in my blog post more information about this and steps on how to get it configured. So definitely check that out. This next one here is also something I'm really excited about as well too, that Microsoft introduced in the public preview, which is called Microsoft Entra API Driven Provisioning. But this is exciting to me because a lot of us are familiar with SCIM provisioning for applications, third-party applications, which allows you to connect to Microsoft Active Directory and simply provision, deprovision, and update user attributes across applications using Microsoft as the source of truth or that third party. And specifically, when we think about source of truth for user changes, it's a lot of the time HR tools or HRIS systems. So that's where the user is accepting offers. That's also where they're terminated. So we would want that to flow into Active Directory to deactivate that user, to create the user, to update their attributes when their title changes, those types of things as well, if we're using that as a source of truth. So this is by no means a trivial setup, but it is giving you the ability here to be a little bit more agnostic because Microsoft only has a specific number of applications that they support for SCIM provisioning and even much a narrower list when we talk about HR tools that they integrate with. Like Workday is probably the most common and popular in the space for this, but we obviously have a lot more HR tools that we could integrate with beyond that. So this is allowing both cloud-based and Active Directory, local Active Directory-based support to be able to provision users from third-party applications like your HRIS tool. So definitely something I might create a separate video for because it is something I'm pretty excited about, but it's in public preview now. Again, on my blog, I have more information about how to set this up, how to set up automation around it as well too. Shifting into Microsoft Intune here, this specific feature, just to preface, is part of the Intune Suite add-on. So it's not part of the base level Intune licensing that you get as the standalone offer, part of a bundle offering like Business Premium, but this is pretty cool to me, much like the Teams feature for proactive use cases, but it's aggregating the anomalies that it's seeing across your devices. And you can see some of those recommendations here in the screenshot, one of which is saying that 5% of your devices had application crashes. And this is giving you direct insights and feeds into that, so you maybe can have more proactive investigation going on. Unfortunately, it's gated behind more premium licensing, but it is a very cool feature. I've yet to check it out myself, but again, might have another video specifically for this. It's GA now, so if you get a trial even of Intune Suite, you can go test this out. Shifting into Microsoft Edge here, this is simply just saying that Bing Chat for Enterprise will be available by default on the Edge mobile app in late August. And the Edge or Bing Chat experience, I should say, is something that you can configure as being on or off within your organization. So if you don't want users to use that for any reason, you can turn that off. Microsoft Excel here is an interesting one because I think it'll excite a lot of people who are well-versed in Python, but this is a public preview of Python and Excel, which allows you to create formulas, things like that, or functions that will be directly incorporated within your Excel grid. And so this is part of the Insiders program, the beta channel you can use as part of the public preview. But this is expected to begin in late August, be complete by September, as far as that early access public preview goes. Shifting into Microsoft SharePoint here, this seems like it should have been in the SharePoint list environment for a while, but this is giving you the ability to create a list from a CSV file and export it to a CSV. So just simplification on creating SharePoint lists. If that's something that you do adopt today, this will happen mid-September and be complete by late September. Next one here is a new feature or application as part of the Office Suite that will be included in your base level licensing. It's more, I think, stream-ish related, but it is part of your experience whenever you're saving files, video files within OneDrive or SharePoint. And this is allowing you to make simple video edits and modifications, as you can see in the screenshot here. I obviously don't think it will be too robust, but it is an integrated experience within the Microsoft ecosystem. This will happen late August and be complete by mid-October. Microsoft Forms here, I don't usually cover the updates because I feel like they're trivial and not really important to the masses, but this one was interesting to me because if any of us have experienced migrations from Google and G Suite, a lot of the times it's not just email we're looking at, it's the documents and additionally Google Forms is something that comes up in certain use cases. So this is giving you an admin interface in the 365 Admin Center to basically migrate Google Forms to Microsoft Forms. So this will happen late October, be complete by mid-November. And then finally here, last admin section, just some more GDAP updates. If you don't know what GDAP is but at this point in time, you can check out my blog for some of the information I've been posting for over a year now, almost 2 years at this point in time. Although many of us should be familiar with this, so I'm not going to go through what GDAP is, but these are just some timeline updates and some updates that they provided. They do this pretty much every month. We all, I think, know that Microsoft's begun transitioning on behalf of us, so they're just kind of moving you from DAP to GDAP, if you haven't done that already, and giving you a preset sub of roles. They are cutting off the ability to create net new DAP relationships in September, on September 25th here. And if it was me, I would already be accepting new customers or onboarding new customers with GDAP, because otherwise you're just kind of creating tech debt at that point, or just time diminishing aspects of this, because you'll have to fix that later on. The bulk migration tool, either through Lighthouse or the command line interface, is going to be available through November. And then this was a new announcement here that I thought was interesting. In October, they're going to launch this capability to extend GDAP relationships by 6 months. And I'm interested to see more of the details on this, as in if this is a one-time, hey, you can just extend it, or this is a perpetual, if you want to keep extending your GDAP relationships periodically every 6 months, then you can go and do that without having to send the customer a new link or do that on their behalf if you're an MSP who usually does that. I think that's a good way to balance both, you know, making sure that you don't just have these perpetual relationships like DAP that lasted forever, but you also don't have to have the administrative overhead, you know, to keep going back in and reaccepting, especially if you have the same exact permissions, those types of things as well. So that'll be interesting to see more about that. And then the final two announcements here are just related to end of support for legacy APIs and subsequent PowerShell commandlets. So the AAD API, more commonly for a lot of us, we know this as the MS Online commandlets, the MSOL commandlets that you guys have been using for a while. You need to be shifting into Microsoft Graph API for automation capabilities there in PowerShell. Same is true with Exchange Online. You'd move into V3 Exchange Online PowerShell commandlets because the older versions are going to be fully deprecated, and they've stopped supporting those as well too. So nothing much to call out there, except for, you know, transition if you haven't already. So that's everything I wanted to showcase for you guys today in this video. Definitely comment below with any of the features you're most excited about, or comments as far as the questions about any of these features. Happy to help there. And like I mentioned, if this content's helpful, like and subscribe if you guys want to see more content around Microsoft and the MSP space. Thanks, guys. I'll see you next week.